Hey, music junkies, professor of rock, always here to celebrate the greatest artists and the greatest songs of all time. If you're nostalgic for the greatest music of the rock and roll era, subscribe right now, hit that bell so you always get our daily content celebrating the best of the era. Also, join our exclusive club, The Dean's List. You can click on our Patreon link below to do that, get more content, and you can help our cause. As a culture, we've been fortunate to witness some truly great icons of popular music, you know, from the 1950s to now. When I say iconic, I mean artists that have conquered the masses, that have had hits for many different decades, from Elvis to the Beatles to Elton John to MJ, from Madonna to Whitney. Truly iconic artists, you know, they have a very thin tightrope to walk. To remain relevant, they have to speak to the masses. And this constitutes attracting all ages, all creeds, all people to a point. But as an artist, most have a desire to push the envelope, you know, an experiment, to emote real human experiences and vulnerability and stand for something that might divide the mainstream. Critical acclaim is also part of that complicated equation. I think a major icon has to have three major character traits. I call it TVA: talent, vision, and ambition. Like I said, it's such a thin line that with one misstep, it could create career suicide and be the difference between, you know, being a one-hit wonder or a one great album followed by a decade of obscurity. Taking a risk is mostly frowned upon by the powers that be. You know, they'd rather these artists stick to the formula when it's working, in fear of a life of Chris Gaines setback. A few artists have done it perfectly. You know, the Beatles, for example. They seemingly went from the easy pop of She Loves You, Yeah, 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 to the deep and methodical songs on Rubber Soul in less than 2 years. The Beatles experimented and the masses followed them. They shook off their, you know, teeny bopper label and became one of the most progressive bands by the end of the 60s. Elvis never really went there, and I think that's mostly due to the Colonel, really. Ditto Michael Jackson. Prince took over the world with Purple Rain, and then he did whatever he wanted artistically, but he never really came close to that commercial peak ever again. I'm not saying it's good or bad, I'm just sharing some facts. It's very rare for a band to find that perfect balance, you know, between art and commerce. R.E.M., I think they did it for a while, you know, U2 as well. But R.E.M., you know, from Document to Automatic for the People, I think it's easier for a band to take a risk after major commercial success if they built it from, you know, indie to mainstream. I think it's nearly impossible for an artist to be the biggest thing since sliced bread early in their career and then try to pull a serious artistic statement at the height of their fame while continuing that peak. You know, George Michael and a few other people have done that. Well, Madonna did this in 1986. After blowing up as the Material Girl with her multi-platinum blockbuster Like a Virgin album, she was preparing to release her follow-up, True Blue, which had, you know, various potential pop hits on it, from the catchy title track to Open Your Heart and La Isla Bonita, all sexy love songs that would easily play to the masses. Instead, Madonna went against all conventional record executive wisdom and released Live to Tell, a heart-wrenching ballad about abuse as the first single, and then Papa Don't Preach about teenage pregnancy as the follow-up. Live to Tell is a pop masterpiece. Overnight, it elevated Madonna from pop idol to serious artist. This song, it's so elusive and mysterious. I mean, nobody really knows for sure what Madonna's lyrics mean, except for her. Some say it's about a relationship with her father. She has said very little about it in the past, but what she has said, and I quote, "I thought about my relationship with my parents and the lying that went on. The song is about being strong and questioning whether you can be that strong, but ultimately surviving," end of quote. Lyrically, Madonna portrays the complexity of mistrust, deception, and holding a secret deep inside. It really speaks to childhood trauma to me. I've had some very deep conversations with people who have experienced, you know, mental, physical, and/or sexual abuse in their youth. Having been a victim myself, I can tell you unequivocally, we have all related closely to the lyrics. I want to share some examples those lyrical nuances that Madonna so painfully yet bravely communicates. The chorus, "A man can tell a thousand lies. I've learned my lesson well. Hope I live to tell the secret I have learned. Till then, it will burn inside of me." This can certainly speak of abuse, those who have been victims of sexual abuse, sexual assault, or rape, you know, who have held that secret inside for so long because of the fear that they won't be believed or that they'll be shamed or scorned. And then there's the second verse that, in my opinion, the best verse that Madonna has ever written and sung. "I know where beauty lives. I've seen it once. I know the warmth she gives. The light that you could never see, it shines inside. You can't take that from me. Can't take that from me." It's hard to say those words without breaking up a little. They're so filled with light, truth, and strength. Madonna's words here give victims true empowerment. No matter the abuse, no matter the immeasurable pain that the abuser has caused, there is a light that shines within us. Depending on your beliefs, whether from God or a higher power, it's that tiny seed of faith and self-worth that simmers in all of us and hope that everyone recognizes that they have that beauty within them. Madonna is saying that it's a light that shines and can never be completely dimmed. And then in the next chorus, after the first part, she says the truth is never far behind. The truth is never far behind. And then comes the haunting bridge, and Madonna gives truly her saddest, most soul-stirring vocal that she ever has created when she says, "If I ran away, I'd never have the strength to go very far. How would they hear the beating of my heart?" I mean, that vocal is just life-altering. And then she asks some critical questions. Will it grow cold? The secret that I hide, will I grow old? How will they hear? How will they learn? How will they know? These are questions that every victim has had to ask. Will this horrible secret grow so cold that it will make me apathetic and numb to my future? Will I ever grow old? Will I survive to have my own family, to fulfill my own aspirations and dreams? Or will I fall apart and cease to cope? How will my loved ones ever hear, learn, or know the experiences that I've had? These are real questions that we have all battled. But Madonna ends the song with the chorus that says, "Hope I live to tell, and the truth is never far behind." The truth is never far behind. These words give us so much hope that we can truly live to tell the tale without fear of reprisal. This song, it just never ceases to amaze me. I've listened to it a thousand times with just tears streaming down my cheeks, and it's empowered me to seek help. I know it empowered countless others to do exactly the same. It's really special to me, this song, and no matter what you think of Madonna, and everyone has an opinion, from this song alone, though, for me, her legend is etched in stone. Talk about talent, vision, and ambition. Madonna has mastered all three, no question. She's reinvented herself too many times to recount. She's written several songs that have changed lives. This one, and the cousin to this song, "Oh Father," brilliant song. So many more that have helped victims of abuse. I really salute her bravery. I spoke to her frequent collaborator and her co-writer of this masterpiece, Pat Leonard. And here's the story of Live to Tell, the number one hit from 1986. As we go into our segment, I want to thank our sponsor, Zenni Eyewear. You can click on the link below to get yours. Here's Pat.
There was a movie called Fire and Ice, and it was being directed by a guy named Duncan Gibbon. And my managers knew him, and so he said, you know, maybe you could score this movie. So I watched the movie and said, I don't want to hear your temp score. And I sat one morning watching and I went, so that works for this movie. And wrote this as an instrumental piece for the movie. And Madonna was coming over. I asked her if she would, as a favor, write lyrics for it, because mm-hmm. I thought obviously it'll bolster my chances to get this film score if I have a lyric by Madonna. And she was on her way to the house, and the director called me and said the producer hired somebody else to score it. So she gets to the house, and because there was no cell phone to tell her to turn around and go home.
Right.
She gets to the, and yeah, good.
I know.
Right? She gets to the house and says, well, let me hear it. Sean's done a movie. Let me hear it anyway. So I play her the track, and she sits on the floor and she writes the lyrics, and she goes in the other room in this little house I had in Coldwater Canyon, and she sang it down on this 8-track demo, and that was the last time she sang it. And that was it. That
really?
That was the record. And wow. It was my demo. We transferred the 8-track demo and added to it. That was it. That was Live to Tell. Hope I live to tell the secret I have learned. So that's where it came from. And then when there was a 2-page billboard thing about how huge the song was, I just wanted to, my managers actually wanted to put the woman's name who hired somebody else and say, write again, and send it to her. Because it was really, it was a big record. In the context of that record, there was Live to Tell, and there was La Isla Bonita, which is kind of a pop song, except it goes, which is not very popular, still not. So that was weird.
Well, it was such a departure, True Blue, from the first two records, which were true pop records, Like a Virgin and Material Girl, and all those songs that put her out there as a sex symbol, and Live to Tell was something that really separated her from the pack, mm-hmm. as far as...
Yeah, I think she had the insight and the wisdom to know to do that. I think, you know, I don't listen to pop radio, I never have, and it's just not my thing, you know what I mean? So
yeah.
People that are really in pop music, I think they really pay attention, so they know what's going on, and they can, you know, anticipate something, or at least use the color that's color du jour, whatever. You know, like, I don't know how exactly it works, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I never did. So it was just hers. I think she just said, I can make, and I always said to people, like, no matter what I play, she can find something that cuts right through the middle of it melodically. So I could just go, well, let's see how far I can take this. And it still sounds like pop music because she's going up the middle. You know, it's nice.
That's why you guys worked so well, because it's very complex for a pop song and the things that you did. And she had a way, like you said, to simplify it. And it's a tough thing to create a simple pop song. That's one of the toughest things in the world.
Yes, it is.
It's funny because I have conversations a lot about my kids love Taylor Swift, and there's Taylor Swift and Beyonce and Katy Perry. And I think what Katy Perry and Taylor Swift could use is a Pat Leonard, because their songs have gotten to a point where they're catching everything, but I want to hear something like Madonna did with Live to Tell, where it was really kind of personal songs.
They just need someone who pays no attention, you know, who can do some interesting chord changes and isn't paying attention at all. And then they do their thing. I mean, really, that's the way to do it. You can't think it. You can't manufacture it. You can't. It's a circumstance where my interest was not in writing 3-minute pop songs, which is why Live to Tell was 6 minutes long. And so it was like a prayer.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's how long it took. And, you know, I just got really lucky. And I think she did too, because it created something bigger than the sum of its parts, however that saying goes.
When you heard the recording and heard the lyrics, did you kind of hear that it was this kind of personal song? Because even you playing the first few chords, that translates into something a little deeper than I'm in love with you, or that kind of thing.
You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I've never had the strength to go very far. It's what came up at that time. The beating of my heart. You know, it was a strange time. I just finished the Jackson tour and was trying to get a movie score and just got told I didn't get the movie score, and I was 28 years old or something, you know what I mean? It's a long time ago. So it makes sense that it is what it is. And those types of moments, the musical moments, they're harder now. they're harder. There was something more open, at least for me, and in me, there was something more open. And, you know, you mentioned Live to Tell and Oh Father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Oh Father has a, there's a similar thing about Oh Father as there is to Live to Tell.
It's almost like the second part of it.
I got away from you. I never thought I...
When you do this, you sort of got what you need. And when you do this, you've got what you need. So that's it. It's one bar, it's two bars. And, you know, ironically or interestingly enough, when I tell other people that are working on pop songs and they really want to get a pop song, I say, it's really simple. Your longest phrase is two bars, nothing more than two bars. If you want this kind of pop music, you know, and I look and I think, yeah, and that's the wisdom of it anyway. Two bar phrase, and that's it. You take that phrase out, you don't have the same song. Not at all. The relationship is this. That's it.
So you were working with Michael Jackson on Bad. Tell me about that. And then you got a call and everyone went
back.
Well,
I didn't do very much of it. I went to Michael's house a few times and sat with Michael and Quincy. And, you know, Michael would sing melodies and I would pick out chord changes. And obviously fun. You know
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, like, it's really fun. And I spent a lot of time working with Michael on the Victory Tour and had that great honor of standing there and playing, you know, playing this and watching him dance. You know, and go like, yeah. Oh, really? This is really happening? With a whole bunch of people looking. The irony of this is that the Live to Tell moment, the Michael Jackson moment, and the call for the movie was all the same day.
Wow.
So she came to the house, did that. I went to Michael's. She went over to the director of At Close Ranges with Sean, and then Sean called me at Michael's. He said, can you come over? And I said, no, I can't leave right now. But, you know, it was all one day.
Jeez.
So, and the other thing that was ironic about it is probably the most ironic thing about it is that I ended up, when I went to Jamie Foley's and Madonna's sitting there, we're talking about this song, and I think they played it back. And Madonna said, who's going to sing it? And they went, you are. It sounds great. She says, too low for me. So, no, it sounds fine. It sounds good, you know? And like I said, she never, I'm pretty sure that's the vocal. I don't remember ever doing it again. Yeah. I remember we might have tried and went, no, that's it. She was really very much a first taker a lot of times. And then Jamie Foley said, Madonna said, you could score my movie. I said, yeah, I can. She says, okay, you're hired. So I was fired from Fire and Ice. Live to Tell got written. I went to Michael Jackson's, got called by Sean Penn, went to Jamie Foley's, and got hired to do film score in 8 hours.
Jeez. That's so, a good day.
Yeah, it's a weird day, you know, and that's how I remember it. It might have been 2 days, but I don't think so. She went off and I went off. Yeah. She went off to see them and I went off to work with Michael. You know, like, who has days like that?
I know.
You know what I mean?
Leave us a comment about this tremendous, this beautiful song. And Madonna, what does this song mean to you? You can hear this song on our YouTube playlist below to get Madonna's classic album, True Blue, on vinyl. Check out our Amazon links below and check us out on Patreon for even more great content. Help us keep the music alive. It's so important. Until next time, truly three chords and the truth, my friends.